I think the whole family's a fan, really. We all really like him, you know. Yeah. We've all been on different occasions.
Yeah.
It's really great.
Do you go a lot together?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
And do you ever argue about what you think about
him? No, we're all of the same opinion. We normally argue who's going to have what seats.
Having seen him twice at quite good venues, why bother to come again?
Oh, God, yeah, I'd come, yeah.
Yeah, you just keep on coming to see him, yeah?
Oh, yeah, wherever, whatever.
Yeah.
If I can get a ticket, I'm there.
That's the new David Bowie, a superstar for all the family. But at 36, Bowie himself has a teenage son and a brand new recording contract. So what does the future hold for him?
We won't really know until the next album comes out whether this... If the next record is very similar to this one, then the critics will be saying that his ability to come up with those surprises has perhaps dried up. Which we'll have to see. His new album seems to be, to me, a step sideways.
Why do you describe it in that way?
Because I think he's not doing anything particularly new. And I suspect that for the first time ever, the fans are up there with him and he's not ahead of the game.
Mm, but
he seems to me to become something rather old-fashioned, which is to say a superstar. Mm.
Does she ask for love and I gave her a dangerous mind?
As David Bowie sings into the sunset, 50,000 adoring fans cheer the opening bars of every song they recognise. Even so, I can't help feeling a little bit sad that the old excitement and frontier spirit has gone from Bowie's music. But there I go, harking back to the old days like an old Ziggy clone. After all, this is Milton Keynes, and it is the 1980s, isn't it? Well, isn't it?
Scary monsters, super creeps, keep me running, running still.
Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence is the new film by Nagisa Oshima, the foremost Japanese director of his generation. It relates the experiences of a group of Allied prisoners in a prisoner of war camp in the Indonesia of 1942. Much of the film turns on the relationship that develops between British rock star David Bowie, playing the indomitable British Forces officer Jack Selliers, and Japanese rock star Ryuichi Sakamoto, playing the camp commandant Captain Yonoi. Selliers has been captured behind enemy lines and faces trial.
I am a soldier with His Majesty's Army. 1 month ago, I came out of the Jar Jar Sinpoa Mountains. I surrendered to Colonel Utsumi of the Imperial Japanese Army. I was imprisoned at Tsukabumi. I was kept for 3 days in solitary confinement. Then I was questioned by Lieutenant Ito. He asked me my name and my rank, and I told him. And Lieutenant Ito asked me, is that true? I replied, of course it is. I'm with the British Army.
Do you mean you would never give a false name?
Let me ask you something. Why would a man who's about to die give a false name?
A Japanese soldier, if caught, would give a false name. But then, a Japanese soldier would never submit to being caught. He would prefer to die.
But then, I'm not a Japanese.
Why? Did you refuse to tell the interrogating officer anything about yourself? You must tell us your past history.
My past is my business.
I'm pleased with the film as a whole. Uh-huh. I think I'm fairly happy with what I do, but the film as a whole, I think, is another Oshima masterpiece. It's a classic movie. It's wonderful.
Yeah, I was deeply apprehensive about the whole project as I sat on the jumbo jet winging my way halfway around the world. I thought, I don't know what the hell I'm going into here. I'd never met the director. He could have been, for all I knew, an absolute out-and-out fascist. David, I didn't know.
I pretty much went for it, not even knowing what the story was about. Only because of Oshima's name, himself as a number one or number two Japanese director. I mean, it's a privilege to be asked to do something with it. And I was even more eager when I read the book from which the screenplay was to be written.
The film is based on Sir Lawrence Vanderpost's partly autobiographical novel, The Seed and the Sower. Tom Conti plays the Mr. Lawrence of the title, a character clearly based on the author's own experiences, especially in his understanding of the Japanese culture and language.
If I hadn't spoken Japanese, I would have been dead instantly, because I walked into an ambush in the far west of Java, where I was trying to conduct a small guerrilla campaign of my own against the Japanese. And suddenly, the jungle rained Japanese on me, all screaming banzai and coming at me with their bayonets. And I suddenly found the Japanese I'd learned in 1926, which was then, 26 years before nearly, coming back to me. And I found myself holding up my hand. You know, there are about 10 degrees of politeness in Japanese, and suddenly the highest degree of politeness came to me, and I called out in Japanese, would you please be so kind as to condescend as to wait an honorable moment? And this was far better than a bomb. I mean, I can still see the look of consternation and amazement on their faces, and the little Japanese officers pushing the men aside and putting his sword in my stomach and saying, is that Japanese you spoke? I said, yes. He said, where did you learn it? I said, in Japan. And that saved my life.
We're just going to work through.
OK, thanks a lot.
David Bowie and producer Jeremy Thomas took the film to the Cannes Film Festival in May for its European premiere. With Oshima and most of the cast in attendance, the film was the most eagerly awaited of the festival. Among the usual Cannes chaos of glittering stars and publicity stunts, the presence of Bowie at the Merry Christmas press conference brought the crowd to fever pitch.
Yes, I have a couple of questions for Mr. David Bowie. First of all, how was it working with Mr. Oshima in this film for the first time?
Oshima-san is quite definitely the very best dressed director I've ever worked with. Other than that, he gave me one of the most fulfilling experiences of my working career in either film or writing or making records. I think it was, for me, a novice actor in terms of film and stage. I think it required of me to summon up a lot of my own life's experiences, which I found quite grueling for the first few weeks until I could learn to apply them to the character that I was playing. I've never played anything so unstylized before. I think that's what made it so rewarding for me.
David Bowie was asked if his experience on the rock scene had helped him when working with Oshima.
Again, as an actor, from the Western point of view, I've given a tremendous amount of help by both Jack Thompson and Tom Conti, who unfortunately isn't here today, but really should, because his performance, I think, is quite remarkable in the film. I think that there was always a common ground in terms of... I tend to believe that Oshima makes... His films are not an impression, they're an expression of an idea. And my writing has always been in terms of expression rather than impression. So I felt there was some kind of overlap in our working methods. So I felt that we possibly understood each other far better than I've, in fact, understood some Western directors.
Fini. Fini.
Sorry, it's finished. It's over.
Was there a clamour to see it at Cannes?
Yeah, there was enormous interest in seeing the film. Oshima is a giant at Cannes, very popular there, and David Bowie, everybody wanted to see it also.
Did it play to full houses in Cannes?
Capacity houses, people banging the door down to get in. Riots, in fact. In fact, that was the night that these students chose to demonstrate outside the Palais.
Do you think this story could have been made as well by an English director, or was it important to have a Japanese at the helm?
Well, I think, you know, if it was made by an English director, the film would have been similar to other stories of this nature, you know, the prisoner of war camp film, The Bridge of the River Kwai, cliches that we're all very used to would have been in the film. But, you know, having a Japanese prisoner of war camp film being directed by a Japanese is very unique in itself.
Yes, sir.
Lawrence, this armament thing, I think we could string it out for quite some time, don't you? Huh? I mean, young Tojo will never notice the difference. How do you think? Hmm? Well?
They're not fools, you know, sir, the Japanese.
John, they know how badly the war's going for them. A couple of months, it could all be over.
Then why not try and stay alive for a couple of months? Sir, I know these people. I wish you'd be guided by my knowledge.
I know these people too. They're the enemy. And you're a British soldier.
Apropos of your 2 months, you know they once beat the Russians.
Oh, really? What school did you go to?
Winchester.
It's obviously nice to do movies like this, which cause people to think a bit about reactions in these extraordinary situations like war. There's all the talk of barbarism that the Japanese, acts of barbarism that they committed, and here we are this morning in the newspaper. We discovered that there are things going on in mental hospitals in Britain, which the Japanese would be horrified at, you know. And we went to war last year, and we were debating the return of capital punishment last week in Parliament. Acts of total barbarism.
Oshima's style of direction is very different to any other director that I've worked with. He's directed in a very simple manner, technically. He's very sparse in his coverage, and he's very, very quick. He shoots at a pace that I've never seen before.
He would sketch out the idea of a scene and give us some basic ideas for lines taken from Paul Mansberg's script, and then allow us, the actors, to throw our ideas backwards and forwards. And just at the point where we thought we were getting somewhere, he would stop and say, right, now we go, and he would film it, and so one sort of thrown into the scene. I enjoyed working like that. I haven't worked like that before in film. There was no facility for having any rushes on the island.
Uh-huh.
So the stuff would be wrapped up in brown paper and sent off to Tokyo, not knowing whether it was going to be good or bad or whatever. And he never saw any rushes during the entire filming. Yet within 4 days of getting back to Tokyo, he'd got a rough edit finished.
Yeah.
Frightening. And we only did maybe 2 takes average, and often 1 take, very rarely more than 2 takes.
What kind of a man is he? Is he a close friend of yours?
No, he's not a close friend.
What kind of soldier is he?
Oh, he's a fine soldier. We had a nickname for him in the 8th Army. We called him Strafer Jack. Strafer is it's kind of... it's very difficult to translate. Strafer is... this is astonishingly difficult sometimes. In any case, he was a soldier's soldier.
To what degree, then, is your book and the film of it autobiographical?
Oh, I drew it immensely on my own experience. I mean, when you... it was a story in the sense that to make experience more true than the experience that happened to one, one needs the alchemy of a story. But there's nothing in the story, and certainly nothing in the film made of the story, that did not happen.
You waited quite a while before putting it down in the form of the novel The Seed and the Sower. Why that hiatus? Was it difficult for you to write?
Oh, it's terribly difficult, even now. It's very difficult to write about these highly intense things that happens to one in life. In fact, when I wrote the first of the trilogy on of The Seed and the Sower, on which A Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence is based, there were moments when my hand was shaking so much I had to wait for half an hour or so before, because it was recalling things that I, emotions that may have been inconvenient at the time, and I wasn't conscious of them, but suddenly they became conscious, and it was like a kind of earthquake inside one's soul.
You mean I'm to die? Because you think if there's a crime, then it must be punished. And it doesn't matter who is punished.
Yes.
You're not by any chance a Gilbert and Sullivan fan, are you?
What?
No. No, you're not very funny, really. I see. So I'm to die to preserve your sense of order.
Yes. You understand, Lawrence. You must die for me.
I understand. But I won't die for you.
Most remarkable thing is that Tom Conti doesn't speak any Japanese at all, and he learnt the Japanese before each scene, or you know, previous night, and the Japanese audience can't tell at all that he doesn't speak fluent Japanese.
I was taught by a Jewish New Yorker, which is it was a strange experience. But he was this chap just happened to be. Roger Palvers, his name was, a brilliant linguist. And he spent all day for a week, every day, for a week, walking up and down the beach with me, dunning this Japanese into my head, what it meant and how to speak it. And then I went through a process of going to Japanese people and saying, listen to this. You come on and meet you, and they would say, and they would give it a slightly different inflection. So I would ask three different people, and they all give a slightly different inflection. So at the end of the day, you were stuck with your own decision just the same.
Well, he's an intelligent actor. I'm a behaviorist. I mean, I'm not sure.